Welcome to Meeting Our Needs, the show about people and organizations who are meeting needs in the Arlington community. I'm your host, Nathan Bynum. Today's episode focuses on the need for health. We'll be learning about three organizations that make Arlington a healthier place to live. I'm here with Jill Christenson, Program Director with Inova Partnership for Healthier Kids, Sarah Hillware, Founder and Director of Girls Health Ed, and Jan-Michael Sacharo, Director of Development and Communications with Arlington Sreetpeople's Assistance Network. Welcome to the show, guys, and thank you so much for coming.
Thanks for having us.
Wonderful. So I want to start with a pretty basic question. What does your organization do to help make Arlington a healthier place to live? And I'd like to start with you, Jill, and then we're going to just go right on down the line.
Great. Inova Partnership for Healthier Kids helps families apply for Medicaid and FAMIS and local safety net providers. So we work in the community to find uninsured families, and then we provide comprehensive application and enrollment assistance to ensure that those families get access to care through Medicaid, Virginia's FAMIS program, or local safety net providers like our federally qualified health centers or county programs, wherever they may best fit. So our goal is to keep school-age kids healthy and ready to learn. So that's how we contribute to the health of Arlingtonians.
Wow. So by having a healthy body and mind, they can learn more and be healthier adults.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. Sarah.
Thanks a lot. I'm Sarah Hillware, and Girls Health Ed is an organization that provides health education classes to girls ages 8 through 17. We work within schools and also within community centers. We recruit volunteer fellows to come teach the courses, so generally there are 5 courses over a 2-month period. And what we do is we focus on all things that are comprehensive to health, so body image, nutrition, fitness, personal care and hygiene habits, and also reproductive health for the girls 12 through 17. And so what we do is we prepare girls to make healthy choices for the rest of their lives so that they become confident and strong young women who are armed with information to succeed.
So you're teaching directly to the girls habits that they can take care of themselves.
Right, exactly.
Fabulous. Jan.
First, I'm just glad to see we've got an extreme here because ASPAN, we work with single homeless adults. Our mission is to end homelessness in Arlington. Which is actually the major health benefit that we can give in the community. We have a wide range of programs, everything, food, shelter, et cetera, but an interesting statistic just to show is why homelessness is so detrimental to your health is, on average, life expectancy drops for a person up to 20 to 30 years after only a couple of years on the street. So we're literally, by getting people into housing for a number of reasons, you're extending their life and making them healthier in the same process at the same time. And unfortunately, so many people who have been on the street for a while, what we call chronically homeless, have been there so long, they get used to it. They don't see a way out. And so getting people into housing can take longer. And we really want to extend their lives, like I said.
Absolutely.
And so I could go on for a bit. I'm gonna make sure that we can talk a bit. But the people who get into housing, we've seen amazing health changes, even with a couple months, just by not being on the street.
Yeah, and I've heard that it's more effective. That's the most effective thing you can do for somebody health-wise, if they're homeless.
Both effective for the person and cost effective to the community.
Right, exactly. It almost, so we'll talk more about that going forward. And I do, on this show, I like to approach needs from a lot of different angles because it takes a lot of different organizations to meet our need for health, to be a healthy community. So I wanted to start by asking, how did you decide to join your organization? What personally drew you to either join your organization or start your organization? And we can go ahead and start with you again, Jill.
So I joined my organization. Our organization, Partnership Healthier Kids, is part of the Inova Health System. So that's been around for a while. And Partnership Healthier Kids was piloted in 1998. I joined in 2005. And I joined because I really have a passion for children. And saw a lot of needs not being met because of basic health care. I worked in the schools before for a short period of time, and I saw kids coming to the nurse's office for very routine things, an ear infection that had gotten so severe that the child was ending up in the ER as opposed to, a simple doctor's appointment that could have happened a week ago to prevent that. Just basic needs. So I got, really passionate about that particular issue, and found a great fit within Partnership for Healthier Kids, so that's how I did. And it's really, the services are there, and it's just about connecting families to those services that they're eligible for.
Nice.
That's wonderful. So I started Girls Health Ed at the end of 2012. So it's a brand new organization. And our, you know, the reason I started Girls Health Ed is because of my own personal experiences, but also when I won the title of America's Miss DC in 2012, you know, I made it my mission to visit schools and to really see what was needed in the community. And
is that part of the process?
No, it was just something that I'd always wanted to do. I'd been an assistant teacher for a little while, and I really love communicating with children and talking with them and feeding off of their energy. Children are amazing. And I also have a passion for young children, especially girls. And what I was seeing when I was visiting these schools was that, you know, I was being asked to talk about various things. Bullying, I was being asked sometimes to give talks on nutrition and healthy eating habits, and sometimes I was being asked to give talks on, you know, confidence and body image. And I found that each time I would go into these classrooms, or I would go into, you know, these groups with the Boys and Girls Clubs or the Girl Scouts or the YMCAs, I would find that kids would come up to me and they would ask me about confidence or body image or self-love. And I ultimately realized that even though I was giving a talk on nutrition or fitness, for example, that it all boiled down to one thing, which was, you know, having the self-esteem to really sort of be able to make healthy habits and be able to manifest health both mentally and physically. And, you know, especially in Washington, D.C., that's where the pilot program was piloted, you know, there's just so much going on, and there's so much disparity within the education system in general. So a lot of times the schools will focus on reading, writing, arithmetic, and things like PE, health education, and other extracurricular activities will be phased out. And so we originally, when we started, we weren't sure if we wanted it to be a nonprofit or if we just wanted to be an advocacy organization to advocate for health education classes within schools. But then, you know, I said, sometimes the best way to do something is just to go ahead and hit the ground running with it. And, you know, so that's how we decided to ultimately become a nonprofit, was because, you know, there was just so little red tape.
Interesting.
Yeah, and so it is very interesting. And so, you know, just in that year and a half that we've been in existence, we found that girls, you know, will set bigger goals. You know, they will raise their hand in class more. They'll miss fewer days in class, you know, because of the way that they feel about themselves. Dove actually has a statistic that 6 in 10 girls will stop doing what they love because they feel bad about the way that they look, or they feel bad about some other aspect of their changing bodies. And so that's what we seek to target.
Sure.
And it's been a great journey so far.
Yeah, it sounds like you've really gotten to connect with a lot of young people, and helping them to deal with their health also helps them to deal with their education.
Oh, for sure.
It's a big picture type thing.
Definitely.
Oh, and once you get a little bit involved, you end up getting a lot involved.
As
you open up to the need, you see the other needs, you see the other go on.
Exactly.
It kind of becomes all-encompassing.
Right, exactly. It? Yeah, you're right.
But my background's actually mathematics. And volunteering in college with a homeless and housing organization, they're like, "You're a big guy. Here's a chainsaw. Here's a sledgehammer. Let's rebuild some houses." But then I actually got to know the people who are going to be living in the houses.
Wow.
And once you actually do, like, you know, say the faster that we rehab this home, the sooner this family won't be homeless. That's a great reason to not go to class and instead, you know, do a little bit of work or whatnot. I'm saying that, you know, whatever, I did fine in school. The reason why I'm at ASPAN, and I did some research on organizations while I was getting my master's in nonprofit management. Was the concept that doing good isn't good enough anymore. We need to do better. Mm-hmm. And the idea of that, knowing that you're doing better means that you're measuring. You're taking data, you're looking at and evaluating your programs. And so there are a lot of organizations out there that are driven by people with great hearts,
sure,
great minds, but they're just doing good. They're helping.
Right.
They don't necessarily have the end goal other than we help today. Mm-hmm. And at ASPAN, our goal is we have a mission, end homelessness, get people into housing. And every single one of our programs, which stood alone, might just look like they're helping, but put together, I mean, self-esteem is a big issue.
Mm-hmm.
Just becoming homelessness is a trauma to a person.
Absolutely.
So one of our mission points is to prevent it in the first place. If people never experience homelessness, the likelihood is that they never will.
Mm-hmm.
But once you experience it once, the likelihood is that you will again. Mm-hmm. So, and once that happens, I talk to people in business schools all the time, like Maslow's hierarchy of needs, mm-hmm. basic needs, mm-hmm. food, survival. Right. And in order to climb the ladder, you got to start there. And so thinking in terms of goals, mm-hmm. if your day-to-day is survival, you're not thinking about the day after tomorrow.
Right.
And so definitely. When I found A-Span, you should have seen my boss when I went in there for my interview. I had a ton of questions for her, like, how are you measuring? What are you doing? Great. Let's get on it. Mm-hmm. I've been there almost 5 years, and it's been amazing to see all of our housing programs grow while we're there.
Yeah, I'd like to follow up on that. How do you tell what your impact is? Because, I would at some point love to hear specific stories because mm-hmm. right. that's what people connect to. At the same time, I am interested to hear how do you know that you're making a difference? How do you know that we're getting closer towards a home, Arlington that doesn't have homelessness?
I'm gonna say two ways, and I'll try to be as brief as I can with all of them. But one of them is, the goal used to be nationally that if someone was homeless, get them into housing. You're trying to move them to self-sufficiency as rapidly as possible. And that always got shortcutted to self-sufficiency rapidly. And sometimes people need a lot more help. Mm-hmm. Saying you've got a year in a program is often not enough for people who might have a severe mental illness or addiction. So like years ago, we actually moved the goalpost 6 months after housing. Are they still in housing? Are they no longer homeless? Great, that's success one. It wasn't nice. If they're self-sufficient, it's that they're still not homeless. Mm-hmm. You know, how do you end homelessness? Get people into housing. Seems easy, didn't eat. It wasn't what people did for a while. But annually, we have what we call, we take the temperature of the county. We have a lot of data we record every single day. But one day a year, same day in January, we do a countywide count of everybody who is either in shelters or on the street. Mm-hmm. And we compare it year to year, we compare the numbers year to year, what they're experiencing, to kind of see as a county, are we all of our programs working together? And so it's not an exact, it's like the census. It's about. And so we can look at subpopulations and see, and like in Arlington, we actually know that more families with children have been seeking help as things become more unaffordable. We've been able to definitely house a lot of single adults. The number of homeless veterans has gone down. Mm-hmm. But there are more people seeking help because we are in one of the most expensive jurisdictions in the country.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
So affordable housing, whenever you hear people say it's a great idea, yes, it is.
Yeah.
Let's work on that.
For sure.
Yeah, but we're not doing such a good job here.
Yeah.
But
there's promise. We still need to keep going.
Uh-huh.
In the county, if you look at the budget that's proposed for this month, they're increasing the housing investment fund. Mm-hmm. We just got to make sure that budget gets passed.
Wow.
And I won't go too much into politics right now, but I mean, yes, those are two ways that we try to measure success.
Wow. And it's amazing that you've been able to lower the homeless numbers even as prices have gone up.
Mm-hmm.
Are there ways that your organizations try to track what's being done? And I know that your organization is just starting up, so
exactly. But so I broke it down when I first started the organization. The first year was going to be our pilot phase. The second year was going to be our research phase. We actually just brought on a program evaluator from Harvard to help evaluate our program and tell us what we can do better. And I think that's so important. You know, each year, regardless of whether you're a new organization or an old organization, to make sure that you're always evaluating, always figuring out what you can do better. Ours is more quantitative, in terms of, just making sure that we're reaching the most girls that we possibly can. But we also have the qualitative data as well. Kind of like I mentioned before, the girls will raise their hands more. They'll attend classes more. They'll be able to set higher goals for themselves. And that for us is very important.
Yeah, and it seems like as the first step, you really have to get in there and do your work.
Right.
Before you.
Exactly.
And then after that, you can start really measuring more precisely the effects that you're having.
Right. Do you have like a before and after survey for the girls themselves?
Yeah, exactly. So we have it's called a Healthy Goals for Life workshop. Mm-hmm. And so we have one before the courses and one after. Originally, we had just had one after, but now we do both.
Get the goal post.
Exactly. Gotcha. Yeah. Yeah. Wonderful.
How many schools are you involved with?
Wow. So we are in D.C., 15 schools, and we just expanded to Baltimore. We work with a few schools in Northern Virginia, actually two new schools in Northern Virginia, also in New York. We brought on two board members from L.A. and Denver, and we're working with a partner organization to develop a program in Indonesia and India. So
that's amazing.
So this is something that we're scaling up.
Is it the teachers in the schools that teach this program, or do you have people going into the schools?
So we don't want to be a burden on the school, right? So what we want to do is make sure that it's as painless for the schools as possible. So we have our own teaching fellows. We recruit them. We usually ask them to stay on for about a year. A lot of times they're, you know, students who are getting their graduate degrees in education or in public health, for example, or they're in their residency, you know, or they're young professionals. And what we like to have women especially come teach the program because they can serve as role models as well and mentors. So we recruit them, we teach them the curriculum, and then they go out and teach the classes.
And your organization sounds like is also taking a load off the schools in some way.
Absolutely. And she brings up a good point. You have to. The schools
Definitely.
Are so overburdened and overworked with just what they need to do, you know, to meet the needs of the kids. So whatever we can do to help make their lives easier as educators, as school nurses, the parents, is our goal. And our hope, kind of what I think like Jan-Michael's is to put ourselves out of business. We would love to not have to do this work anymore. So one thing that we really focus on is try to find out what the barriers are for people who are trying to apply. Anybody can go to the local Department of Family Service and apply for Medicaid.
Right.
A lot of our families that we see don't have success on doing it on their own. English is their second language. Maybe they aren't literate. Maybe they work a job where they don't get pay stubs. So how do you prove your income to qualify for these programs if you are a day laborer or if you are self-employed?
Absolutely.
So our goal is to really find out what are the barriers and work with the local Department of Family Services and the Virginia DMAS, Department of Medical Assistance Services, to figure out ways in which we can kind of alleviate those barriers for families. 80%, I think it's about 73% today of our population is English as a second language. So all of our staff are bilingual.
Wonderful.
And so that's kind of our goal. And we're partially funded by the Department of Medical Assistance Services to do this outreach and enrollment. So they like to hear the data from us on what families are experiencing on the front line. So.
And how has the data changed since you've been there?
Well, we piloted our first programs in Fairfax, and we've seen really kind of saturation in the Fairfax County schools of, you know, we've gotten a lot of those. The schools have been amazing and receptive, and we've gotten a lot of kids enrolled in Fairfax. And we've recently just expanded to Arlington and into the Arlington community, so we're looking forward to seeing more impact here as well.
Well, welcome.
You know, it's a very transient area, so there's always new kids to enroll, and as you know, they know, you know, the job is never done. So
Absolutely.
There's always families who need it.
But exactly.
I'm sorry, we were picking up a keyword. So we're out of taking the burden off and the cost savings that we provide. And I know we could go on about this, but one of the things that we're always trying to do is if we get people into housing, typically our guys are using the emergency room far less.
Of course.
Calling emergency services far less. Mm-hmm. They're not in the jail. They're not, and all the emergency workers are not being occupied. With them, they can do the rest of their jobs even more efficiently at greater cost savings to the county. Mm-hmm. And I know every time when we're coming to fundraising, we always like to show the benefit to the community. You know, we spend $80,000 on nurses for a two-year program. People are like, how are we going to fund that? So that $80,000 program probably saved $800,000 at the ER. How can we not fund this?
Exactly.
I know you have numbers like that to compare as well to show, listen, we're giving you less work to do and saving you money. Maybe we fund. But whenever you're trying to put that up front, people see the number you're asking for as opposed to the benefit until later.
Over and over again, I just see examples of how an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure.
Absolutely.
Right.
And
absolutely.
If only our budgets were focused that way, we would save money in the long run.
You said it. You said it.
Civil rights quotes I always go through. Frederick Douglass, it's easier to build strong children than repair broken men.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, absolutely. And we see that all the way down the line. Teach better habits, do better in school.
Yeah, and I used to be a school counselor, actually, and it was in Fairfax, and I'm imagining a student whose parents maybe don't speak English, imagining there were a lot of kids whose parents were day laborers, and I'm imagining them going to get Medicaid and hearing about it, being excited about it, but then they ask for a W-2 or pay stub. And then they don't get it, and then I know when I deal with the government, and I'm fairly well educated, I get or a corporation or the government, if they say no and I've filled out the paperwork and I thought I was going to get something, I get really sort of frustrated. I could imagine if I didn't even it would be demoralizing to someone in that situation who's trying to get health care.
Right.
And that leads me to any specific stories that you have of the people that you've helped. We've talked about the amazing impact that you're having and what the data shows, and also how efficient spending our time and energy in these prevention sort of ways is. Mm-hmm. But can you share a specific story of somebody that your organization has helped?
But one story I can think of, just last week we had a family come to us. They had recently lost their health insurance. It was employer-based, and they had never utilized services, you know, government-funded health insurance programs, and their child was diabetic. So they had a limited supply of insulin left, and were very concerned about what was going to happen next. Applying for Medicaid doesn't happen overnight. You know, it's a 45-day process, business day process, to be approved, and so they were very concerned. So after all, we are Partnership for Healthier Kids, and that partnership is key. So we helped the family complete the application, but we also worked with our partners to make sure that we could get this child some insulin in the meantime while the application was in process.
Yeah, that's an emergency.
It is. Yeah, sure. It really is. And we see cases like this all the time. Mm-hmm. Prescription meds are not easy to get when you're uninsured, and when you really need it, like something like insulin, it becomes a very serious concern for the family. So we worked with a partner to get the child a month's worth of insulin, and we also worked with the Department of Family Service to try to get that application expedited so that they can get the Medicaid enrollment and get the services that they need, and make sure that he can continue his insulin regimen and continue to stay in school and ready to learn and not have any hiccup in his life. So
So you're working in there with short-term health needs, emergencies as well as making it a long-term sustainable
thing. Unfortunately, a lot of times the families that come to us have an urgent healthcare need. You don't really think about health insurance until you really need it. And so I feel like we encounter more and more issues like this each and every day. But our team is so fantastic. They have built up huge resource lists of community partners, and that's what we spend a lot of time doing is finding those networks and how can we help outside of just Medicaid and helping this family apply, how can we meet their other needs as well.
Wonderful. Yeah. Well, thanks, Jill. And Sarah.
I have several stories, but I think I'll start with this one because it's the most recent. So there's a girl I mentored, and we're friends on Facebook. she's in New York. She's a high school senior, and she's applying to colleges, right? And so, you know, she's very talented. She's very bright. You know, she's been through a lot. And that's often the case with the girls that we work with. A lot of times they've, you know, been through a ton of things. You know, they come from broken households sometimes. Sometimes they've, you know, suffered abuse and things of that nature. And that really harms their development. And so so we're friends on Facebook. And I recently saw a post, and she said, all my friends keep posting about prom. But before I can even think about prom, I have to lose a ton of weight. And it broke my heart, and I you know, didn't really expect her to say this, because, you know, on the outside you see this really you know, talented, she's a writer, and, you know, she's a really talented young woman, and then, you know, to hear her say something so, you know, devastating was very hard for me. And after we talked, you know, and after we had a chance to communicate, you know, I told her that, you know, what you should be doing right now is enjoying your senior year. You should be enjoying your life. And you really shouldn't be worried about, you know, how you look to the point where it's going to debilitate you. And I feel like she finally understood. And that to me was really rewarding, to see her finally get that, you know, her life shouldn't stop because of the way that she felt about herself. And, you know, just so now we're working with her to help build her self-confidence, and she's looking forward to going to prom. And I think that's really important. And I just hope that she'll carry with her throughout her life that, you know, she's beautiful, and that, you know, she should, you know, have the confidence to, you know, to see herself as such. But that's just one of the many stories. Mm-hmm. There are so many stories that I could tell. Mm-hmm. But I think that one really kind of illustrates some of the struggles that girls go through when they've been through so much to, you know, break down their self-esteem.
Right. Yeah, and it actually does form a barrier to doing things that they want to do.
Oh, mm-hmm. For sure. Yeah, definitely.
Wow.
I agree. It's hard to pick one. And definitely, coming from a human service agency, it's always we want to share our stories. Because mm-hmm. the more often we can share stories, more often maybe we can help someone else. Mm-hmm. But coming from social work, we know the first rule is confidentiality.
Right.
And definitely at A-Span, it's been a culture change to kind of encourage people to tell their own story. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. here's how we've kind of done it, and I want to lead into this. But the moment someone receives their key or signs a lease or opens their door to an apartment is literally the moment that their homelessness has been ended. Mm-hmm. We've achieved mm-hmm. our mission. So we very politely ask people if we can just take a picture of that moment, if they're willing to share it. And so we have these pictures in our office. We call it our wall of smiles of all sorts of people receiving a key and lease and whatnot. And at first, people are like, well, I'm not sure we feel comfortable showing pictures of other people. But then other clients have seen these pictures and said, I want to be on this wall, mm-hmm. and it encourages them to get the work done. Mm-hmm. And it can be very hard to get back into housing once you've been evicted, lost your housing, whatnot. So now I have all these, I'm going to call them, you know, the after photos. A few years ago, we actually did a campaign on the street. It was a health survey called the 100 Homes Project, 100 Homes for 100 Homeless Arlingtonians, part of a national campaign to house the most medically vulnerable homeless people in the country. As part of it, we ask a very intense medical survey, but we also take a picture of people so we can find them again and offer them services. So I actually have a file of before photos, and now I have a file of after photos. So I'm going to send you the photos so you can actually put it in this.
That's wonderful.
I mean, this is a story of Ernie, and I'm going to share this and show this. But I mean, he was 60 years old.
Angle it towards the cameras there.
Yeah. I'm sorry. He was 60 years old and only been homeless for 7 months in the photo on the left. He'd been working day labor after he'd lost some jobs. He's like, I can make it. I can do this. I'm not homeless. I'm fine. He couch surfed. He did whatever he could and then ended up on the street and lived under a bridge for 7 months until, as a 60-year-old man, he threw out his back doing day labor. Mm-hmm. That's mm-hmm. when he finally asked for help. And thank you for holding it, by the way. And then 11 months later, we got him into housing the day before Thanksgiving. And if you actually look at the before and after picture, I mean, it looks like he got younger by 10 years instead of gained a year. And this is literally, this is living inside, access to healthy food, basic medical attention.
That's
totally visible what's going on.
Bedrock of health.
Yeah. Absolutely. So we have a few pictures like this. Everybody, their privacy is number one concern, but it's just amazing to see a change like that next to each other. But I mean, that's the result of years of work.
Yeah, I've seen the website too, and I believe you have some of those pictures, or maybe not on the website. It might be doorway. I'm not sure, but I've seen.
We have a lot
some,
on Facebook. Every single move-in, it's just like this is a moment to celebrate. Let's get that out if we can. We actually had a move-in yesterday afternoon, and it was just a morning. Days blend into each other, don't they? And every single one is great.
I'd love to talk to you guys for much longer, but unfortunately, it's time to wrap up. And thank you so much for everything you've shared. This is Nathan Bynum, and thank you for watching this episode of Meeting Our Needs. Please check out the websites for Inova Partnership for Healthier Kids, Girls Health Ed, and A-Span. See how you can get involved and meet your own need for community and contribution. Thanks for watching.